You have probably wondered, how fast are those action potentials traveling down a neuron anyway? Well, here we present how to measure conduction velocity in neurons using a two-channel spiker box, an earthworm, a Faraday cage, a laptop, a ruler, and some balsa wood. You can find earthworms in your own yard after a rainstorm, or you can buy them at a pet store, a sporting goods store, or even a gas station, depending on where you live. Now, earthworms can handle cold temperatures quite well, so we have to use a chemical means to anesthetize them. I create a 10% alcohol solution by mixing 10 milliliters of 80-proof vodka with 30 milliliters of tap water, and I take one of the healthy worms and put them in the solution. And I wait about 7 minutes for the anesthesia to take hold. It's important not to wait too long or else you will pickle the earthworm. I then place the earthworm in tap water to remove the alcohol solution, and then place the earthworm on a piece of balsa wood. You should become familiar with the anatomy of the earthworm. Make note of the clitellum, which is the fleshy, fatty part near the anterior end or mouth of the earthworm. You will use this as a reference point. Now you need to make two measurements to measure conduction velocity, and we hereby announce our new two-channel spiker box. The two-channel spiker box comes with three electrodes, a ground I am placing near the anterior end of the earthworm, channel 2, which I am placing near the center of the earthworm, and channel 1, which I am placing near the posterior end of the worm. The sewing needle electrodes are placed directly into the earthworm, slightly off the center line. Don't worry, the earthworm can recover quite well from this experiment, and he will be returned to his soil after we are done. Now, the earthworm's nerves are actually myelinated, so this makes the electrical signals we are recording much smaller than we are used to than with our cockroach experiments. In addition, the earthworm is a terrific antenna for electrical noise, so we have to enclose the earthworm in a metal mesh called a Faraday cage. Once we have this, though, we plug the two-channel spiker box into our laptop and fire up Audacity. Open up the preferences, select audio I/O, and in the device output, select built-in output. On the device recording input, select built-in input or line in, and make sure to select two channels, that is stereo mode. Also select hardware and software playthrough so you can hear what you are recording. Hit record and you should see two channels of information streaming across your screen. Maximize the display of the two channels and also zoom in on the y-axis so you can see the signals you're recording. Why no spikes? That's strange. Welcome to sparse coding, when a single spike means a lot. Let's take a closer look. What you are hearing are one or two spikes elicited when I touch the posterior end with a toothpick. Now, since I'm brushing the posterior end, the spikes caused then travel down the length of the earthworm past the two electrodes. Let's take a closer look. I'm opening up the recording I just made, and again, maximizing the window and zooming in on the y-axis so I can see the spikes clearly. You can see about 15 spikes in the recording. Let's listen again. Now, to measure whether there is any time difference or lag between the spikes on electrode 1 or top channel and the spikes on electrode 2 or bottom channel, we have to zoom in at much smaller time scales as these spikes can occur quite fast. And as you see, as I move in on very small time scales, I see there is a difference between the two channels. I can measure this time difference between the two dips, and this comes out to about 4.6 milliseconds. Taking into account the separation between the two electrodes at 0.03 meters, this comes up with a conduction velocity of 6.5 meters per second, or 14 miles per hour. I can do this analysis for every single spike in recording. I'm going to zoom out of my recording here and pick a different spike to do my analysis. Focusing back in at a very tight time scale, I see again the lag between the top and bottom channels. And again, I can measure the difference between the dip on the first channel and the dip on the second channel. And I come up with a time difference of 4.6 milliseconds, exactly the same as the previous spike. That's interesting. Do you think it changes for different spikes in the recording? Why or why not? Now, this 6.5 meters per second conduction velocity is actually on the low end for what we would expect in an earthworm, which should normally be between 10 and 20 meters per second. Do you think the anesthesia had anything to do with it? Do you think there was any error in the accuracy of my measurement with the rulers or the time? We'd love to see what you measure and what you come up with. Backyard brains, neuroscience for everyone.